So we'll talk about adjacent to our development at Skype, and this will be more like, you know, hands-on, behind the scenes, little engineering secrets and stuff like this. And I don't want to talk all the time and you just sit there. So feel free to ask questions during the presentation. Okay? If you will feel that your questions are answered, then at the end of it, we'll have some time. We'll have like 15, 20 minutes for your questions. So basically, the topics I will talk about the topics now. And if the topic is ended and we discussed and we move on, please ask your questions about it right on top before. Don't want to jump between these different things. Right, so basically, my name is Andrei Demski. I lead a team of software engineers at Microsoft here at Skype. What's Skype, you probably know already, right? It's rich experience to talk to your family, have video call, send iMessages, exchange SMS to the mobile phone or whatever, send files, send pictures, share screens, stuff like that. And I would like to talk about Microsoft branch here in Prague. So basically, we have a development site here, development site of Microsoft. That's one of the very few in Europe. So Prague has about 100 people together, engineers mostly. We are located in the center of the Smicha. And mostly we are focused on web development, or web technologies, web products, and cloud services. Right, so a bunch of different, totally different areas. One is very, very front-end, and the other one is, you know, this back-end stuff, Azure, cloud, things like that. And of course, yeah, feel free if you want to join. We'll talk about that more at the end. There is plenty of positions, both for engineering and product management. So we are hiring all the time, sites constantly grow. Okay, so what we do in Skype and with Microsoft. So our motto is deliver awesome Skype experience and also have fun with doing this epic stuff, right? And what it means, awesome Skype experience, we'll get to that. And having fun, it's essentially part of the daily job, or we want it to be a part of the daily job. We don't want to be like, you know, this like corporate oriented, only doing business 8 to 5 and then go home and nothing. We want to have a little bit of connections besides the work and the spinning of the family. And I think we're quite successful at that. So what we do by awesome Skype experience, I mean this. So the topics I will talk about today will be mostly applicable throughout Skype engineering in different places, but I will use my own team as example sometimes, right? And this is an example of what our team is doing. This is a web Skype, so you can go to open the web browser. You don't no longer need to install the client software. You can have calls there, video calls, you can have a group conversation, share stuff. That's the answer to what. And this is the team, right? Having fun together. Around one of our areas. So, moving on. Okay, a little bit of history first, right? So, history of Skype has begun almost, it's like 12 years ago, 2003, and some private companies owned a stake on that, and in 2005 was acquired by eBay, as you can see there, right? And then till 2009, it was owned by eBay, and then for just 2 years, has been acquired by Silver Lake and Andreessen Horowitz, this group of investors. And if you notice, eBay sold it to Silver Lake for almost $3 billion, but Silver Lake sold it to Microsoft for 8.5. So how did we do that, right? So just 2 years, and during these 2 years, I'm talking about Agile today. These were 2 years when the Agile transformation at Skype started. Before that, it was mostly like ad hoc, you know, organic growth. Everything is organic, people know each other, they just slap things together and ship it out, and people download stuff and it works, right? Organic, it's like user base, everybody's amazed. This here, it's when the series, you know, transformation in the culture also began to be using this agile stuff. So it looks like 2 years of using agile adds almost $6 billion to your valuation. You probably want to know how to do that, and that's what I want to talk about today. Stuff that we've done and how we arrived there, where we are today at Sky. What does it mean to use agile? What are the processes behind it? And how basically you increase your valuation by $6 billion. That's how, right? You get your sleeves rolled and covered in the mud and dirt all together and suffer and have fun a little bit. That's basically the Scrum itself, right? That's where the word originates from. These people are Scrum together. So how many of you have the familiarity with that? Like hands-on familiarity? Great. Okay, so not a lot, but so I'll touch a little bit on the basics, and then feel free to ask more about behind the scenes and stuff. So this is not sacred truth, right? It's not a holy book. It's just a high-level understanding of what Scrum is, and I'm simplifying it a little bit just to talk about important stuff. But I split it into these four pieces, right? The team, the backlog, and product management, basically. We'll talk about that today. Ceremonies of Scrum, what they do. And sprint release, that's the final outcome. Okay, and I'll try to cover these four topics going forward in bigger detail. But again, feel free to stop me and ask questions if you're interested in some specific. And I think that we'll spend most of the time around the team, because team is like a key centerpiece of all this, of what we are doing. In particular, in Sky, we think that it's more important to have the right people and build on this diversity of skills and understanding and the culture than to have some mindset or skill set hired for the job. You know, the people who come with a certain attitude and want to continue with that attitude and stay the same. I'm a C# developer and I'm a C# professional and I want to be like that. That's one attitude, but we are looking more for people who are like passionate about what they are doing and want to move forward, want to learn new things, and want to be flexible. That's what agile is for, right? We put people above the process and the buzzwords, I have to say. Okay, we think that really people is the start, is where you start. What do we do for people? We try to hire very, very different people. And I think we are also quite successful in that. We have, as of today, almost 30 nationalities in the office here in Prague, and more than 10 of them are in my team. So if you take just any average random team in the office, it's most likely that you will have people speaking 10 different languages. And I think this is the right ingredient where you start. And also we want to see people with really different backgrounds and culture, right? They speak different languages, but they share the passion for something. And this something can be from their private life, sometimes, people who love to be sea captains and they have ships and boats and they sail, or they run this 200 kilometers as an Ironman. So we have all these people. And this is where the agility and Scrum starts. If you put right people together, they can do anything. However, traditionally, and I'm going now into functions and roles, if you look at any organization, traditionally there are some functions, right? You have clearly defined teams. There's a manager, there's another manager, this is development team, test team, product management, and you name it, right? Different teams. I should say that in Microsoft, now we have just two. We no longer split in three, but we have two. We have engineers and product management. There is no separation between test and dev anymore. It's a combined engineer. So there is no dedicated role to test stuff. It's engineering. It's core part of the engineering itself. So typically, if you start with some formal organization layout, we look like this, right? Some bosses, some other leads, and they manage individual teams, right, or individual people. And then more and more, and then they may have different functions. So let's say this is development or engineering, and this is product management. Okay, it's a boss. Formality laid out. So while this exists, of course, and Microsoft as well, we want to eliminate these invisible borders here and these invisible borders. So we try to mix people into teams by, again, by their passion, skills, desire to build things. So in Scrum teams, when they organize, when the Scrum says the teams are self-organized, I have these two guys from here, plus this guy from here, plus, well, let's say this guy, right? He's maybe a lead himself, or developing. But that's, this is Scrum. This is organization, formality, and this is Scrum. Okay, we go across the borders. We try to mix people together from different areas of different corners of the organization. And the roles that you have in Scrum are just like on this slide. So product owner, Scrum Master, and engineers, right? So basically it's a set of engineers inside this box, and then product owner and Scrum Master. And we'll talk more about this as well. And product owner typically comes from PM organization. We don't change this role, so that we don't have the approach where engineers lead product management, because PMs are usually good at talking to other people and convincing them, or basically in establishing connections to the market. So people from this organization, there is one PO, right? So this guy is product owner. I'll expand more on what he does on the next slide. These are engineers of the team, and we have, let's say, Scrum Master. These are three roles in the Scrum team. Okay, good questions.
Awesome. But are you still developers from other teams? They realize when they can be just speaking to you?
We try not to steal, right? But it may happen that people are joining the team from quite distant organizations, right? So maybe like this. So two levels apart, it may happen. We don't want to do this very often because it starts to break these formalities and structures too hard, but it may happen, right? As an exception, yes, it may happen. People from other teams who are interested in some specific area, or they feel this passion, passion is the keyword. If somebody here has the passion and the skills and desire to build or help this guy do something, and build that, it's more than welcome.
So if I understand it right, these people, they are in some infrastructure as a normal corporation, but then they can have something like kind of a hobby, which is basically a Scrum project, and they can jump on into it?
No. That's how we make Scrum teams out of formal teams. The principle is that we go through the boundaries. We don't make Scrum teams like this.
So we don't have these structures at all? You don't have these structures at all?
Which structures?
Like you have a boss and then you
we
have
do, we do. That's what I'm saying. So we do have formal structure, but when we create Scrum teams, we allow these people to mix from different formal structures.
And they are focused entirely on this project within the
yes,
Scrum.
Or component. Mm-hmm. Okay. So when the Scrum teams are being formed, we allow these boundaries of the Scrum team and encompass the boundaries of the organization. Okay. So as a comparison, that's what I'm trying to explain here. We don't want to always end up in Scrum teams like these, where you have a team lead and three developers, let's say, and with a head, guys, you're a Scrum team lead. Okay, and this is Scrum team lead. Although this is also possible, which what works the best for the team, if they happen to be already divided in a way that these guys share a passion for something very similar and close, and these guys as well, and these pieces are independent and can function independently. Why not? But overall, the preference is to mix. Okay? When we can do the mix, we prefer to mix. Okay? So this is the Scrum team formation, and Scrum teams are created either for subcomponents or entire products. Okay, it can happen that the product, like a full product, can be done by just one Scrum team, but the product is quite simple, right? Because the average size of the Scrum team is like under 5 to 7 people. If you get, so you can imagine 5 to 7 people, they can build the entire project or product. That doesn't happen very often. Normally, it's a mix of several Scrum teams, and I will talk about that towards the end of the presentation. How do you scale from one to many? How do you organize and subdivide them? So, okay, now more about roles inside a Scrum team. Product owner, Scrum Master, and engineer. So, product owner is basically this guy. He stands in front of the endless opportunities or endless options. He has like tons of questions from everybody and zillion asks from the product, marketing team, from sales, from his boss, from somebody else, from users on the forums, from everywhere. There's lots of requirements coming to product owner, but in Scrum process, his responsibility is to manage the backlog, and the backlog is the list of order asks for the product, right? So it's like feature requests or component requests or something like additions to the product, changes. And this list is ordered by priority. But product owner naturally stands in front of this wall, and his most important function in Scrum, I believe, is to say no. So when there is a million of asks flying around, the very important stuff for product owner is to be able to say no, to learn how to do this, and to reject something that doesn't make sense. Because otherwise, the team won't survive it. So the backlog, this stuff that product owner creates, is a list of requirements, right? And they are ordered. This is top. This is bottom. And they go order like this. This is most important to do, this is least important to do. And if you notice, I draw them like smaller boxes on the top, and you're right there by constantly managing backlog to get to this shape, where at the top you have very finely decided, specified, well prepared, ready for execution items. And here at the bottom it's like some question marks, right? Ideas. And they move from bottom to top. So team takes items from the top of the backlog for execution and starts working on them, so it's like a step, right? And team needs to help product owner to prepare it to get to this state. Okay, questions? Is it clear? Right. How does product owner orders the backlog? Normally it's a set of different principles, but mostly it's either business priorities or return on investment. So the priorities, ROI, return on investment, or just priority for the product overall, which means that at the top you have something that gives you the biggest bang for the buck, right? Investment that you need to make to execute this item, to make it happen, to add it to the product, will have the biggest return, and so on. So this is the biggest ROI, and this is the smallest ROI. These priorities for the product are going in this direction. And we have product owners who and compost different areas as well. So it's not that one product owner works on a single feature or single component or single area. Normally, a product owner has to be able to overview the entire product and all its related topics. How do you work with customers? Where you get feedback from? How do you ship your product? So it's not divided into technical things. It's something, the backlog talks about something that's ready to go to production. And items in the backlog are things that are adding value to the product. It's not that much internal stuff, but more value addition. That's okay, the functionality behind it. So product owner's job is to make sure that at the top of the backlog there are items which are adding value to the product, and the size of these items and their state is all in good shape. We call that grooming. It's kind of like, so grooming the backlog gets you there. Sometimes people ask the question of how do you split or combine product feature asks and technical requirements, because it may happen that, for example, people want to see the new feature in the product, being able to start a call with 100 different people at once, but engineers at the same time are saying, you know what, to be able to do that, we need to refactor this whole area and it will take us 3 months. So engineering team itself has a list of ideas or things that they want to do, but product owner normally looks after something that adds value to the product itself or that users will like. And sometimes it's very hard to manage both of them, but we arrived at the conclusion that essentially at the end of the day, the asks coming from the engineering team are going to benefit the product anyway. They just have to be sold in the right way to this guy, to the product owner. Because if you refactor some area of the product or some component, it may happen that you just start to develop faster in this area going forward, or that it has less issues, for example, the quality of the product goes up. So we never split, or we try to, as much as we can, not to split into technical requirements and product features here. It's all product additions. So it should add value to the product. Even refactoring, it should clearly say that by doing this, we are improving the quality or performance, and now there's less memory will be used by the application, or it will be able to serve more requests, which at the end of the day gets product to be more likely to be used by more people, or they will like it more, things like that. Okay. Good, and move on. So details. How do we arrive from having an idea other by EO or the team here and moving it up this direction to be ready for execution? First, the ideas are usually discussed in the smaller focus groups or smaller teams which have the necessary expertise in the given area. So the product owner wants to talk about some specific feature ask or new direction for the product or adding something new, he may first talk to several people who are already either engaged in this area or have been interested in it previously and have the skill necessary and knowledge and the ground to be able to discuss this. So we already have these smaller groups where there is a set of different knowledge areas and expertise is being shared by these people, so they can talk about almost anything, right? So if we have a team of 50 or 100 people, or an organization as large as Skype, you can find almost anyone who will be able to discuss this idea. Okay? So these focus groups provide feedback, early feedback to product owner on his ask. Maybe it's not a feasible question, but maybe it won't happen. This feature won't be developed in the time the product owner implies it should be, or it's not feasible now, or the technology is not in place, or vice versa. Maybe it will be quite simple and simpler than the product owner expected. So there is this first iteration where the idea is being discussed with experts from technical side and then product management from the other side to arrive at the common conclusion, like, yes, we want to do this, it's feasible, makes sense, let's move on. If so, product owner creates the item in the backlog and specifies this ask for feature component addition. And then grooming of the backlog is just like normal periodic activity in the Scrum team. We get together with the PO, with representatives of the Scrum team. Product owner presents the item. He talks about why we do it, what's needed, what's the benefit for the product, how the user will get value from that, and wants to hear from the team the estimation of the complexity or its average size. Right, so the estimate is usually there is a series of numbers, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 12, 100, progression, where 1 is the simplest item and 100 is the biggest one. And the estimate has to be done by all the teams in the room, all the people in the room, in the Scrum team, and they have to arrive at a common conclusion. We don't average, we don't divide numbers. So when product owner explained the item, what needs to be done, if everybody understands in great detail and all the technical ground is being laid out by one of the experts that's participated in this initial discussion, so when everybody totally understands what needs to be done, we just raise small parts or just say our estimation out loud. And if there is like a big discrepancy, if one person thinks the size of the item is 2 and another person thinks it's 13, we don't proceed, we don't say it's 5. We just say, hey guys, let's talk about it. Why do you think it's 2 and why do you think it's 13? Maybe there are some assumptions hidden that the rest of the team is not aware of, or maybe the guy who has estimated it at 2 knows something that makes it much easier or simpler to do than the rest of the team. So we want to have this discussion as far as possible. And if you don't arrive at a common conclusion, it may happen that we just say, right, it's not ready for execution yet, we can't estimate, so let's move on. Let's go to the next item, but this time we'll talk about the next grooming meeting. So product owner will have to go back and talk again to engineers and find out details why there has not been common agreement on the estimation. And why do we estimate? Because we want to calculate our return on investment. So if product owner thinks this is the most important thing to do, number one, it's so amazing feature, but it turns out to cost or have a size of 100 points, just bringing it up, and we'll talk about numbers as well, then the value of this item is not that high, right? Although, it adds something to the product and users will like it, executing on that is costly, so it falls down. Okay, and vice versa, maybe this item here is some decent stuff, but the cost of it is just 1. Why not do it, right? It's very easy, it adds value to the product, so its ROI will go higher. Generally, as a principle, we want to keep these items very small. So while I wrote out the scale up to 100, we never go above 8 in practice. We say that 8 is like, it's to be. 8 is on the verge of being actionable. So 1 to 5, that's what we accept. 8 is to be. Let's split it into smaller pieces. We try to make these stories or items in the backlog simple, clean, understandable, very easy to talk about, very easy to implement, very easy to do, I guess.
Do you agree with with some, if I say user story or item have to value, it's have to be, the user story must have value, some value. And what if I can't split this item into two items without these values?
Yeah.
Okay. I have 13 or 20 item or user story value, and when I split to two, I have no value items.
Okay. If I understood the question correctly, the problem is how do you split when product owner thinks it's not separate, right? How do you make it smaller when they think this is a single piece and we cannot go further? In practice, from what I've seen over all this past year, it's always possible to split function. It's just the approach from product owner and the team, right? So product owner has to be educated by the team and the engineers on these mechanics behind it, and the smaller you go, the easier it is to build a product, right? And you don't, when you always come with ideas to build the entire house, right, it's too complex to do it in one go. Although yes, you can sell the whole house, but it's too big. We always want product owner to value small things, right? That's the education I'm talking about. And most product owners won't agree with me, and of course they want to sell as much as possible in one go, right? To be able to say, hey, next release, we'll add this huge feature and everybody will love it. We want to say that even the single, simple bug fix adds the value to the product. It's one bug less. So yesterday something didn't work, today it does. Okay, that's already value added. Or, you know, just placing a button in the proper position, maybe we found out from user feedback or from our telemetry that it's hard to discover some UI element or people don't know how to use it. So if you just move it out and make it more discoverable, it's also value added. It's very simple, right? So we try to build these ideas starting from the assumption that you don't need to sell the entire houses. It's good if you sell just, you know, there is a nice carpet in your room. It already adds value to the project. So start with the small, yes, you have the vision, the grand ideas behind them, but make them into smaller pieces, break them down in the head of the product owner first. Because if it doesn't happen, then yes, the compromise is very hard to achieve. The product owner keeps insisting, like, yes, this is the whole single story. I don't want to discuss it anymore. This is one piece, and I don't want to break it because it's not splittable. And the engineering team insists that it's too hard for them to be able to work on the thing. Okay, because we also want to go into short cycles, and I'll talk about releases as well. Because yes, if you want to plan for 1 year of execution, maybe you can build this entire story. But we don't want to. We want to ship very frequent, very fast. Very easy. Even if we ship in small pieces, we believe that they are ready to grow.
And you don't have experience with some big overhead with managing these items? Because, for example, I can have a form in a website, and this form have maybe 50 elements, and every element can be written as a single user story with their own value. But for product owners, it can be a real big overhead for creating and managing and all that stuff.
Yes, okay. This is a good question, but the cost of doing this is shared by entire team. It's not only product owners. So that's why I believe we also go hand in hand. It's not that we just say as a team to Leo, you know, man, you just need to go back to your desk and split this further. We do this together. Grooming meeting, that's where we do this. We tell him, hey, why not split it this way, for example? Why not between scenarios of the user, right? Or maybe the market or platform support, or things like that. Yes, maybe today this feature will release it. It doesn't support all the platforms, but it supports the most important one. Let's do them first. Then part the rest. Let's put it like that. Just bringing up these examples, but we do this together. Engineers and project owner doing this together, so the cost is shared. By doing this, we avoid putting the blame or most of work on people's shoulders and act together as a team. But yes, you're right. If you go very, very fine grained, then there is certain overhead in managing it, but usually the backlog also, the good sign of the good backlog is not going more than several iterations long. And I'm likely going forward to the release cycle, but let's say that the team releases every week, so building the backlog for half a year in advance doesn't make sense. Do it for 2-3 weeks, that's enough, right? So you avoid trying to have a full or big, large, complex backlog. That's also how you solve this problem of minimizing overhead. Prepare for a few iterations in advance. Don't go very, very far into the future, because by the time you arrive there, all these ideas, they will probably change. Most likely, they will either become irrelevant or lose their value, or they have to be reformulated anyway because the conditions on the market has changed, or intentions from the other product owners have changed and you need to compare it with somebody else. So yes, to minimize overhead, we work together as a team and do this splitting together, and B, we don't let the backlog to grow to be, has to be managed right. To be of a decent size, when you look at it, you should be able to basically encompass the entire backlog in one graph. Just look at the screen and keep it going. Avoid scrolling like 10 pages from one page to another to understand what the backlog and trying to find the right thing. Okay?
Yeah.
Yes, please.
So you recommend to have just a few disused stories items, details, for a few weeks.
Yes.
But what if you have some product which you can build in a few weeks and you need a few months, and you need to know the release date?
Okay. And the typical answer to that would be that Scrum is not for you. If you are going besides a few weeks of iterations, then it's already too large to be able to apply these flexible and agile principles to this development process. If you release once in 3 months, sorry, it's already kind of asked for a different methodology. You need to think first, because of the iteration cycle is too long, and you want to minimize the risk, you want to think very hard before you're starting to do something, right? And this also takes time. So normally, the use of Scrum is not advised in this condition. You'd rather try something else. Although I've seen the team who are able to do this as well. Which, yes, it means that the backlog has to be larger, but yeah, that's the conscious decision. You just decide to go this way.
And how do you deal with some bigger functionality in Skype, which takes more than 3 weeks, like launching some new product or part of product?
That's a very good question. Yes. There can be some idea or feature, whatever you call it, which is, let's say, split between 10 items in the backlog. Scrum formally says that every single item should be shippable, should add as an increment, should add value to the product. That's what we try to do. But if we want to roll out this whole set of things together, right, then we develop them as such in these small items, groom, estimate, develop, add to the product, but keep them turned off until we execute the entire scope. Okay, so the development goes on and takes them all and puts them into the product, but it never reaches the production. We just don't deploy this feature to production, it's turned off. We have internal mechanisms which prevent these features or unfinished sets of things, epic stories, right? Big, large things, reaching the production before it's totally done. Okay. But Yes, that's a good question to talk about in more details if you want to hear how it's being done. But yes, there is technicalities built into the development cycle which all this could happen.
Another question is kind of related to the situation. It looks like tasks are connected, so if you relate something for 8 and you solve it, other tasks should be, let's say, re-related because part of the job is already done in another task. Should you do a calculation on this?
Okay. If I understand correctly your question, you asked about the case where two items are related with each other, and the work done in one item may help the second team.
Yeah. Well, that is not one of the
Okay. Our principle in my team is to estimate them independently. Because again, Scrum says that they should be shipped independently, right? Tomorrow, maybe the priority changes, and although the items are related, they are actionable independently, and you may want to ship first, but not the second. Yes, even if they are related. So we say that let's estimate them as if they don't have connection. But in the situation when we've done this, then executed a few more, and then this item still stays on the backlog, and we come to the grooming, and before executing on this item, we may re-estimate. That's also part of the grooming. So every time we come to the grooming session, we look at the backlog and say, hey, this item has an estimate already, but it looks wrong. Right? The goal of the grooming is to make backlog in the right shape. At the top, finally, great, well understood, well estimated, very well prepared, ready for execution items, and the bottom some big ideas. So even normally, most of the grooming time is spent on producing this shared understanding, right? The estimate, the number itself is not that important. What's the most important thing, as I mentioned before, is arriving at the common conclusion. When people estimate it to one size, it's just a sign that they understand it similarly, right? So getting this common understanding is very important. So later, even if it has an estimate, you may still look at it and say, hey, that doesn't make sense anymore. Let's break it down again or estimate it again. So we not only estimate items which are not estimated, that's what we have to do this, but look at something that has an estimate, but it may not look right. Okay? So yes, if it had dependencies in the past and they're already done and executed, that may help this item, it may reduce the complexity. Or vice versa, the examples, I've seen examples of those. By doing something, you discover more areas or things to do that you've assumed will be all done by the title, right? So you may discover that hey, in the next item, that you have to do more because we didn't think about A, B, and C.
So the point here is they are changeable, so they're not doing C.
Absolutely, yes. Yes. The point is that once you produce an estimate, it's not set in stone. Yes, please.
You said you have kind of many independent, but related, or let's say, cooperative teams, for example, front and backend team. Sometimes there are tasks that are, let's say, shared between those teams.
Okay.
I can create a button somewhere, but if there is no backend logic, it doesn't make any sense to actually put the button into the UI.
Okay.
So you probably need to groom like together, but you can't really groom in 100 or 200 people because so many teams are working on the product module or whatever you do. So is it product owners who groom together?
Okay, that's a very good question as well. So should I erase this, please? This is solved differently by different teams in Skype, right? So there is also no. We don't have one size fits all solution. What I'm talking about is like sometimes examples from my own team, but mostly we allow teams to be flexible and choose what they believe is right. Okay. So I have this picture here about the Scrum information, but there are two approaches possible. Let's say you have a product, and as you've mentioned, it consists of several layers, right? There's some technology layers or dependency layers. This is UI, this is some middleware, data, whatever, backend systems, cloud. There are two ways how you can organize Scrum teams in this situation. Either you go this, right, horizontal, and they may have more Scrum teams inside, right? Three, just the UI, independently split into screens or whatever scenario. So people who do the video call, right, all these pieces of UI, people who do sending the IM over Skype, they do separately. And another team doing backend, and so on. Right, so you have horizontal layers. In this situation, when you organize companies like these guys have their backlogs, right? Independent backlogs. There's another B. And if this piece requires this work to be done first or together, you cannot ship this without doing this, then it has a dependency, right? And because we use the single engineering processes system to track the issues and estimate the work, we can link them together in this system, right? There is no hard wall where this visibility is being lost. All these items, backlogs, tasks, are all existing in the single system. We can establish connections between them. So we may say, hey, this item, this backlog depends on this. And because teams are independent, they have their own estimation. But yes, EMs have to first agree that they share the understanding. If you have teams like these, it also implies that you have PMs or product owners, different people here. These guys have to agree and reach common understanding of the priority, right? Because if this guy thinks it's the most important thing to do in our product, and this guy will work on something else, his dependency will be not satisfied in time, right? So yeah. Communication between POs is required. Or we can go and do something else. We have teams who do it. We can create strong teams like this. Okay? We can create strong teams which don't possess the vertical piece, the slice of the product, and they're responsible for shipping the feature like end to end, from the backend development to the UI, everything. So this single piece of functionality belongs to they develop in some area. So again, maybe this example of video call. So let's say we have a team or Skype that provides the ability to have a video call. So we would have a team who works on generally, let's say, video related scenarios and providing value to user being able to start a video call. And when we want to have a call with, let's say, five people at once, that's the next story, next item. Expedia, they will have to do it end to end. They will have to work here, here, here. So we have to have a set of people who have all the expertise, knowledge, skills, domain knowledge in all this area. Right? Verticalization. Or, as you may logically imagine, we have a combination of these. Right? We not necessarily do only this horizontal splitting or vertical splitting. But we combine. Sometimes you may have like one or two layers horizontally and then vertical pieces on top of them, standing on top of them. Up to some level, these are very independent, very self-contained features which can be really worked on independently. And this mostly happens, this horizontal formation of the Scrum teams, when the area that they work on is being consumed by more than one upstream team. Okay? If it's only one team sitting on top of this, then I would link into this verticalization. Right? But normally it's a good practice to do this horizontal splitting in some layers if there is, like, let's say, it's like this. Right? You have cloud to store messages, message cloud. And this is being used by five different other products, 3, 4, 5, whatever. This is, I don't know, Quick Chat or Skype Quick on Android. This is Redline. This is something else. Okay, so when you have some service or component which can be shared by others, that's well where I will do this horizontal splitting first and then vertical on top of it. Does it answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Spikes, yes. I didn't mention that. Sometimes it may happen that when estimating, people arrive at the common conclusion, which is we would know how to solve this, but we need more technical knowledge or more investigation to be performed before we actually go to execute on the Python, right? Because it's like, although it sounds like understandable, a feature of decent size, 10, we would like to prefer some small investigation first, because there is a risk that we misunderstood. Okay, and we call these things spikes. So before doing something, although we have ideas how to do this, we create technical spikes and we don't estimate them. We say, hey, before doing this item, for example, at all, let's have a spike to go and investigate what's behind it. Try things a little bit prototyping, hands on more, but normally we limit it by time more than the size. So we don't give it the size, but we say, hey, 2 to 3 days, a few people sit together, they look at this ask or feature or area, prototype, write some code, try new things, and then they go back and provide input to PO to add more details to this item that we are going to execute. So the outcome of the spike is usually the technical design or recommendation of how to do things, which helps, again, okay, the next iteration, which helps share understanding of the people who are estimating, okay, this is in reality how you do this. This is what's feasible, so now our estimation is fixed. And we understand it all together as okay, so we have this special activities, not very often, okay? Because it's a sign of some blend error. Normally when you do the spike, it's a sign of that something is not very well understood either in the technical side of things or in this product. Right? Maybe the design is not very clear and you have doubts that this design will work well with the rest of the application. So we want to try it first, a little bit of prototyping, and PO cannot do it himself, right? Normally PO isn't scalable to also sit down and write the code and try things in the reality before specifying the PO. What else? Reprioritization. As there was a question about the re-estimating, that it may happen that the priority of the things change as the grooming goes along. Right? So it goes, let's say, re-estimation, or after the spike, you found out some more things to be done, or just time has passed. So PO moves things up and down. So depending on the time, when you want to execute things, and their priority, and ROI, conditions on the market may change, or you may see another dependency on some other product. The backlog is dynamic. Priorities may change. Although we want to see the top of it very stable, that's the general idea, but some flexibility is needed there as well. And then, if we get all this done correctly, then you arrive in a situation where the top of the backlog is very clean, simple, understood, all estimated. And the next ceremony or activity in the Scrum is to plan for execution for the next iteration. Then this planning goes very, very easy, very natural. You just pull the chunk, the top chunk of the backlog into your upcoming sprint or starting working. Usually we do this on Monday. So we have sprints from Monday to Friday. So on Monday, first thing we do is we plan for this next sprint. We look at the backlog, take a look at the top of it, clean and simple, clear, pull it into the sprint, and that's it. It's like 5 minutes, like a drag and drop, one page job. And the only thing you have to do here is to adjust for velocity. I mean, Scrum velocity is the concept of historical data which helps you to say how much of these estimations, or how many of these items, the team will be able to execute, right? It gets accumulated by time. So if you just created a fresh Scrum team in a totally fresh area of your product or your component or something like run wild, then it needs some time before you get this reasonable data on the velocity, like 5-10 sprints, ideally to be able to understand that this given team executes to the velocity of, let's say, 50 points per sprint. So people, then when planning for the sprint, dragging the top of the backlog into the sprint for execution shouldn't normally exceed this 50 point. And sometimes you have to adjust for non-velocity related, but capacity related. It's like people go to vacations, or somebody gets sick, or there is an important training and you have to attend for 2 days. There is resource concept involved as well. But usually, because this thing happens every week and there is stable cadence of execution and everybody has no review what's going on, you know things in advance, it's more or less the same. Just pull it up to this velocity mark, and the tools that we use, Jira, also allows this to be seen right in the backlog. There is a setting and it draws your line and says, hey, your team velocity is here. So that's plan. After you plan and took this chunk of work into the sprint, that's where it should stop.
What do you think about estimating subtask, subtickets of user stories, which are created on planning meeting, some subtask as creating, preparing some data for user story and other?
Different teams at Skype have different practices. So some teams, what they do is that they estimate the parent task or story, it's not for task, the story, and then at planning, they not only take this story into execution, they break it down into actual execution items or subtasks, and then estimate subtasks independently, differently. Okay? They may estimate the story in the story points, in the size, in the complexity, but they may estimate the subtasks in actual like time to require to do this. And then they track time spent on this task. Or some teams, they actually aim at having, yeah, the same principle as I mentioned, they aim at having stories on the right side so they don't have to go to be split into actual subtasks. Yeah, if you have the size of the story small enough and well understood by the team, all the discussion how to do things and what is there, how to verify it, all the assumptions, all the dependencies, it's all sorted out in the grooming. So we don't need to create a subtask for it because it's already shared. It's in the heads and it's in the specification.
And there is no problem with parallel work? Or because one story is not only one developer every time.
Yes, of course. Yes, absolutely. You may have few people working on that together, like pairing, and that's also a practice that we prefer. Normally, having one story done by one person, like end to end, from implementation to verification to done, that's not a healthy sign in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And we prefer different people to look at it at different stages or combine few people together to do it end to end, right? Maybe not the full time, so somebody may do, let's say, a piece of that, do some implementation or preparation for the work, and then somebody else will join later and help finish that. So that's also the practice that we do.
And which practice is better from your views?
Depends on the team, right? What works for the team is what makes sense. Although, yeah, say the people are different and we hire very different nationalities and the culture of the ground, usually what's needed is this initial agreements inside the team, right? Once the team arrives at the agreement, that our process is to have subtasks and independent distribution of subtasks. And they do it for several iterations, and it works well. Go for that, right? Maybe some other team right, sitting right next to you don't want to do this. Maybe they feel that for them it's more natural to have stories of a smaller size and to people combining all the time. So we let the teams decide. And for that, I would come on with your perspective. So yes, with your perspective, you evaluate how you do it. Other questions? No? Okay, stand up. One of the key points during the execution, every morning, people just stand together, right? You're familiar with the concept like this. They have a board. We have the board, which is electronic, so we don't use these stickers here. The wall. It's just a big, large. I can basically scroll down. Yeah. If you see behind the guys, there are two monitors. So on these monitors, we project our task board. It's electronic on the system, right? The site where you see all the tasks in your current sprint. So team has to stand together, has to be very sure, and all the functions has to press right. If you don't have people attending your standup, that's not good. If you don't have all the engineers attending, it's not good either. So usually all the people in the team should come together. And the key questions that we want to hear the answers for are what has been done, what will be done, and what is preventing you from getting things done. Right? We don't go too much into detail. So technical discussions, if there is like starts to be some discussion about how things are going and I have this bug here or blah blah, I need to look at the code. We take them aside for a deeper dive after the stand-up. So let's stand up, it has to be very focused. What has been done? Since yesterday, our product has this feature, right? Since yesterday, we can now do X. Yesterday, it wasn't there, today it's there. So since yesterday, we've added A, B, and C. And we have tasks in front of you on this board. You just point at the tasks and say, hey, this is my task. It's done. Yesterday, it wasn't done, today it's done. Then we say what will be done, right? We say, with me, this is in progress as of today. I'm at stage of investigation. So here we have a little bit of specifying the stage, right? Just saying that I will work on X today is not very helpful either, because you may say this for five more days. Like, I will be working on X, I will be working on X, I will be working on X. We want to hear people mention like a phase, maybe they need help. I'm at the investigation, or I'm implementing, or I'm done, there's a few more things to verify, stuff like that. That's what will be done today. And then, so-called impediments, right? What prevents you from moving? Somebody may mention, I have this task, I'm working on that, but I cannot proceed today because the dependent PBI in some other team is not ready, although we expected it to be ready, or there is some other issue has been uncovered, or the system is not working today very well, or whatever. So impediments, if something is impeded, you flag it as such, just to others to see that the item cannot be proceeded, and the person can take something out. And that's it. So as I mentioned, we always try to avoid these very detailed technical discussions on the standup. If there are some debates, right, or people feel about, very strongly feel about some topic, and somebody may say, yes, I've done this task and it's working, everything is good. If somebody disagrees or want to debate it, it's not stand up or it should happen, it should be taken aside. Okay, stand up is very focused, very careful. Okay, questions on that?
Yes, so please. How much time does it take to advance stand up?
15 minutes for a team of like 7 people.
Okay, and these part of discussions about some programs and
afterward. So again, it's in my opinion, it's a good practice if everybody comes to stand up prepared, right? So you don't just make a blank book at the board. You know what you've been working on, and you may say in advance, like, guys, I'm blocked by this, or I have issues here in this area, or I need help from somebody, so let's discuss it afterwards. I'm at the investigation stage, I think I found something that changes our assumptions on how we implement. Okay, so don't discuss this internals on the stand-up, because it gets other people bored, right? Everybody's standing, waiting for their turn, we let everybody speak, right? It's not that informal discussion, just go around the table, basically, right? As this feature implies. Everybody has to say something, including the PO, because PO is part of the team, and he also works on moving the product forward, so maybe he has an input on some of the features we are working on, heard from other teams, or things like that, dependencies, or he may say, hey guys, I've unblocked the impediment that you've raised yesterday, that you depend on somebody else. I saw, I've sorted it out for you, and now you can work it forward. Okay, and all the technical discussions after these 15 minutes, make a coffee, sit down at the keyboard, do this together. Usually, I've seen that it takes time. So when you start doing some stand-up, A, you may not finish in time, and B, some people may not get a chance to talk about what they've done or what is their impediment. It's very important for everybody in the stand-up to have a very focused approach and ability to say what they've done and what they will do.
Okay, and is there a limited time for everyone, like 5 minutes?
No, we experimented with that as well, and basically it evolves with the team, right? If you have a very fresh team, not very familiar with Scrum yet, or the Scrum Master, and we can talk about that in more detail, is not doing a great job, then you may start with the approach like, hey, everybody has to meet, for example. Okay, good. Let's start a hot watch and give everybody just 2 minutes to say, if you didn't fit in 2 minutes, sorry. This kind of this pressure on the people to finish in 2 minutes and to be prepared next time. It's like more policy approach. Right? So when the team is young and not prepared, this stronger control may be practical approach, right? I'm not saying it's better, I'm saying that it may actually help them work well. But later, when the team gets familiarity and everything works smoothly, you don't need a policeman with the stick to tell them that take this discussion aside, please. Okay, so we prefer to give people responsibility, and yeah, I forgot to mention this Scrum Master responsibility. So some teams do it as a Scrum Master is somebody who is like almost the boss of the team, and it's not very nice, right? The Scrum Master has to be a hard guy who actually watches the process, right? But agility and agile manifesto in general values people over the process. So we also want to value people more than the process and, you know, staying true to the book and have these rules in place and everything. So even if we have Scrum Master, we prefer him to be more like a source of good advice, so to say. Right? Tell guys, if you have troubles with working on this ticket, please talk to me, we'll find you a pair. Or if you feel that you're impeded or blocked, talk to me again. Or please let me help you in moving this ticket to the verification step. Things like that. Okay. We don't want Scrum Master to be something that, again, runs around with the stick and makes other people obey to the rules. Although it helps, right? It's pragmatic, very focused, very rigid. But we value people and relations more hard by the good over. Okay, and one more thing that we do, although not every team practices that, but many teams do in this guy, is rotation of the Scrum Master. Because Scrum Master is not something like, you know, holy or untouchable. Scrum Master is not the boss. And he shouldn't be. He shouldn't say or tell people what and how to do. He's a helper, right? Facilitator. if people are late to the stand-up, he will just mention that, let's maybe wait one more minute. John is just running the stairs because the elevator is stuck, right? So let's wait for one more minute and give people a chance to see each other.
Well, but then I think that you are kind of against Agile Manifesto because, well, why the Scrum Masters are the people that are usually, I mean, in usual Scrums, the Scrum Masters are the people that are most experienced and only these people, and they are sometimes taken as the holy grails of the team.
I'm sorry, but I haven't seen Agile Manifesto say it.
Well, this is behind the lines, I guess, a bit, but...
Well, maybe, but we don't want to approach it, at least. I'm talking about Skype and Microsoft, and we don't want to do this, right? Quite the opposite. We want everybody to be able to feel what it is to be a Scrum Master, because, let's say, really getting behind the scenes. Let's say that some people are late to the stand-up every day, or they are lazy and they don't explain well their things. Telling them every day to do this may not really help, but when the next time comes for them to be the Scrum Master, and although they may not be stellar at doing this, right, it's a conscious decision by the team. Do you want to risk a little bit of this smoothness of execution in favor of everybody growing together, right? So you give the responsibility to someone else. That's how you evolve the team. You tell this guy, hey man, next week, maybe you can try to be a Scrum Master, right? And when people do this, they actually start to see these relations or relationships and mechanisms and checks and balances behind it, what it is to have a well-functioning Scrum team and people understanding each other. So not only it helps to share the knowledge and spread and grow the team, but these individuals may improve as just Scrum members moving forward.
And it does really work.
It does work, yes.
Huh? That's cool.
You have to be brave, although, right? And some people are just not made for this. Again, what works for the team makes sense, right? Maybe I, as a manager of some team, may feel that let's rotate the Scrum Master sheet, but the people in the team just don't want, right? They say, like, hey, the Scrum Master, this guy that we have now, is a Scrum Master. He's the best Scrum Master ever. We love him. So let him do the stuff, right? Mm-hmm. Why forcing this function on somebody else if they're not interested. They're not interested, don't do this. So do what the team wants or what the team thinks is helpful and gets things moving forward.
So the Scrum Master is usually an engineer as well?
Yes. Scrum Master is an engineer. Okay.
So you set on start this on daily stand-up, there is important to be there POs too?
Yes. That's the practice that we have in our team. I've seen different approaches in different Scrum teams. Somebody say that PO, they try to follow it. They say that PO is not committed. Okay? Because the Scrum description say that there are people, pigs and chicken, right? Chicken are, how do they say, involved, and pigs are committed because chicken only lay eggs, but bacon is like, you know, it's getting off your body. And the engineers are committed because it's their sweat and blood, they put it into the product. And they kick out the PO of these meetings, and only do these other ways of synchronizing, like Scrum and Scrums, or maybe, you know, just like POs talk between each other. This may work as well, okay? If it helps team to move things forward, and the team is more efficient without PO, why not? But in my opinion, and what I've seen working better, if you get to a certain stage of common trust and shared understanding, then having the PO present on your stand-up, it's like, really helps, because PO is part of the team anyway. You don't have Scrum team and PO. He's part of the team. He needs to know what's going on. He needs to hear about these impediments because he is the guy who may help to get the result. He needs to know the state of the problem. So we try to involve PO as much as possible in everything we are doing as a Scrum team. So Scrum team and PO will all follow. Yes. Okay. Or more questions about the standups and stuff? No, I think it's clear, right? So, like, sprint and release. Our iterations are, again, varied, different. Some teams have sprints of 1 week, some teams have sprints of 2 weeks. Some teams have two sprints per release, right? So they have 4 weeks of iteration to get the product out to the market. Some teams don't have releases at all, they just have one release every week by finishing the sprint. So the sprint ends, this is an increment to the product, it's working, they can verify all items are done. So here you go, just deploy it and works well. And again, as I said before, normally it's adapting to the team size and the complexity of the product. Right? On the web, in particular, the web technologies, it's very easy to develop fast and deploy rapidly, right? Because you can have some configuration update in one place, and here we go, millions of people are now using the new version. While in, like, let's say, mobile development, where you have to install the native client on all the phones, you may prefer the phased rollout, you know, right? Maybe you don't want to deploy a version to 10 million people in one day. You want to gradually roll it out slowly and watch for things. And this needs full native application development. It takes a longer time to validate it. Maybe the tests are more complex because it involves, I don't know, more devices and hardware and operating system combinations and stuff like that. So again, this varies by team, and team has a good say in how often do they do. But overall, we follow the Scrum and Agile approach in that every iteration there is an added value to the product. Right? It comes from the backlog. Since we've started with the backlog, where every item adds something, even if we just one, right? Let's bring up artificial example. Even if we do just this one item in one sprint, and sprint is very short, it's already worth it to put this in front of the real users, because it may help them to do things that they weren't able to do yesterday. And that's how you get from question marks to smileys, having people for using the product and providing a great product. Okay. We try to get to this stage where we develop fast and we deploy fast and we have fast feedback. So the example or the question that was mentioned before about 3 months development. Yes, you can do this, but I believe that it's much better when you have rapid development cycles and very close feedback loops, that you hear what people are saying. Okay. What else? After the iteration ends, we have demo. So we just demo the product to the entire team, because it may happen that in this breakdown of the teams, it's 5-10 teams. Scrum teams working together on a very big project, for example. So not everybody is fully aware of all the work around and the state of the entire project. Although yes, you're working in your area, you may know what's going on there, but it's great to get the entire product team in one room, POs included, and demo the product, all these things done by all these teams together. It helps them to establish the shared ownership, to see the actual, you know, this final building at work. So get feedback from POs, right? They have to confirm basically that what they are seeing now is what they have meant here by creating these stories and these ideas. And if increment is is accepted and POs are saying, okay, hey, that's a great job, then we just go ahead and we release it. Right? Although PO may say, okay, although we've done something and I see added value, we don't want to release this now. Okay? Maybe the times have changed and we need another feature, or there are other products waiting for deployment next week and we want to make a combined release altogether. So yes, this may happen as well. And it's not the bad news for the team. It's just the team continues as normal. The working increment has been produced. Value has been added to the product, it has been demoed, and it's now the PM call if they really put this to production. If they want to, we go ahead and release. If they don't want to, that's not the problem. I mean, right? Or maybe just the time is not well. It's like Christmas vacation period. All engineers have gone skiing to the Krkonoše and like, nobody's around, so releasing this out to the 10 million people or 8 million people, there is no one around to get the feedback, watch if release goes well, things like that. It's a normal situation. And then the final stage of completing the iteration is to perform a retrospective. So team gets together again after the demo. We get together and we talk about improvements for the next iteration. And I've seen in other companies, like overall in the industry, the biggest problem, in my opinion, with retrospectives is that people talk about good and bad things. Okay, they start to reflect what was good, what was bad. Doesn't matter. What was good doesn't matter. What matters is what helps team to deliver and what we haven't done yet, which will help team to deliver, right? So maybe there's something that was bad, but it didn't impact the ability of the team to deliver the working increment. So there is no point in complaining or wasting time in debates like it was bad. Or maybe there was something good, like we went to beer all together and we had fun for 2 days, next day nobody appeared at work, everybody has hangover, and how the guys in the sprint are not delivered. Right? So it was a good time that we did this drinking party, but you know what? Having a working increment is probably more important as from the business side. Okay. So having parties in the middle of the week is not helping to deliver. That's what we say in retrospective. Say, hey guys, let's have parties on Friday night. Let's not have them on Monday. And things like that. So we try to talk about things that help the team. What doesn't help and what helps. If it helps you to deliver stuff or move faster, have shorter iteration, give more high quality code, have less issues, things like that, it's cool. If it doesn't help or we are doing something that slows things down, that's a good point. So our questions is not what is good and what is bad, but what we should continue doing to improve our delivery and shorten the release iteration time and what we should stop doing, right? And sometimes in continue, it's also like start, right? Because maybe there is a new idea flying around and we want to try it out and maybe it will help actually. Or some new tools or engineering process or a new framework is coming out this week, so let's try it out. Maybe it will help us to solve these 20 bugs just in one way. Okay, so if it helps, let's do this. If it doesn't, let's not do this. And we, one more important thing here is that we don't want to stick to these hard rules yet, right? But something has been said in retrospective that let's do this and it helps, let's continue doing this. It doesn't mean that it will always be so, right? Maybe after 3-4 months, this approach is wearing out, the team no longer is interested, or it's just adaptation time has passed and excitement is no longer there, so it's not helpful. If we need to change to something else that may haven't been positively viewed in the past, that shouldn't be a problem either if it helps to deliver, if it unblocks the team, makes everybody productive, makes things move forward more easier and more productive, then yes, let's do this. So opinions, they matter. We want to have this relationship and people can discuss things, but talking about bad and good, that's in our world. Okay, questions? Now, really behind the scenes with that. What about quality, right? So, normally, bugs don't fit very well into the Scrum overall and into the back office. Like, right? You discover bugs and that's a version of the estimate. And they have complex lifecycle. You have to discover bugs, you have to
prioritize them, you have to fix and verify, so they're like almost like another world and new stories. And our approach at Microsoft is so-called zero bug policy. So if you work on something and there is a bug that's been discovered, you stop the feature work. So as soon as the bug is being discovered, you stop the feature work and you have to address the bug for it. We don't want to accumulate hundreds of bugs and spend hours every day reviewing all these bugs and deciding if it's worth it to fix it and when we'll fix it. Put it to backlog, wait for grooming, and then estimate and talk about it, and then maybe it's too low in the backlog because the feature is more important than the backlog. We've tried many, many things, and basically, my team in particular arrived to the conclusion that it's much easier to work on bugs when you discover it. So if there is a bug, just fix it now, or accept the hard fact, together with product owner, right, we involve more people, it's not just one person decision. It has to be a good judgment of several people to say that, hey guys, yes, this bug may happen, but we think that it's okay to have product with this bug. So we don't waste time on leaving it there and then coming back to it later in 3 months. But just accumulates that. So fix it now or don't talk about it. That's our approach. Okay? So we don't have, normally we don't have bugs on the backlog and we try to avoid estimating them and treating these bugs like a product or user story. We want to fix them as soon as possible. Okay, and one more concept that we have in Microsoft as a company is a DevOps. We don't have separate operations teams. So people who have produced the product are responsible for that product ultimately in front of the users and in the market. We don't want to one team to produce the code and give it to the other team to support. It has been done in the past this way, today we don't do this. We've introduced this DevOps combined approach where the team that has the product being developed owns its support in the production. Okay, we have rotation, we have telemetry and tools, we build them as part of our framework, so this is also being treated as part of the backlog. We create stories to build tools because they are contributing to the value of the product. We are being able to detect issues in production. We have these dashboards and telemetry, health indicators, alert systems all in place. And how DevOps works is that people from the team are being rotated in the duty. So we have a phone with some number, and there is an automated process in place. This process watches some key metrics around the product, like, let's say, number of messages being sent per minute. If it's a steady pattern, then suddenly it drops. So messages are not being sent anymore. Below a certain threshold, then you just get a call to this mobile phone and you have to answer it even if it's Christmas night, right? So the person who gets assigned for a DevOps gets this responsibility to track the health of the product. And then this resolution is the next step, right? Maybe the issue is not that serious and you can deal with that in the morning, or maybe that's serious that you have to call your boss and involve more people and get somebody into the office to sit down, look at the code and see what's happening. Right? Maybe some services experiencing difficulties or specifically, especially in the case of Scrum teams which are organized like this, which on the end to end, they know what's going on there. Right? Maybe it's some backend which is having troubles and this UI feature is no longer appearing. You guys have to go the keyboard. And so our rotation is 1 week per person. So one person from the team gets assigned for DevOps for 1 week and then gets responsible for the health of the product in the production environment and feedback from users, proactively watching all these dashboards and to be able to detect them.
Yeah.
Yes. Did you just say that some exact person is responsible only for DevOps and stop doing?
No, it's a normal duty, right? Because our product is so great that we don't have many incidents. Normally, during the day, the person who's on this call, the DevOps duty, he does his daily job, right? If he's not working on some serious incident, he does his normal daily job. Although, if the incident happens, this takes precedent. If something happens and you get a call or you get a notification, well, you just discovered yourself, right? You come to the morning, in the morning to the office, and you discover that okay, some metric is going down. Let me take a look. Oh, okay. Some services are failing. I have to address this now. So my PBI, sorry guys, the rest of the team has to accommodate, has to take care of that, pick up the work from where it was left. And this, yeah, and this gets proper incentives in place, right? If you get called every night, you have to address incidents, you then don't have capacity to work on features. You have to improve the product first, right? It's maybe some hidden technical debt. So you have to get to the stage where you don't get called every night and then their execution on the feature continues. That's what people prefer, right? Nobody likes to be to spend nights on investigating what's going on the server and analyzing the data. Okay, so this puts incentive in place for engineering and Scrum teams and PO, for everybody to think about the quality end to end, because they know that you will get assigned and you will have to track the product, and if it goes down, you will have to fix it. So better develop the code in the first place in a way that you will avoid these calls during the late time. And so far, in the team that we have around doing the lab Skype development, it's not that every day, right? So it's not that scary for engineers in Scrum. Sometimes, yes. And to be honest, it's mostly it's other infrastructure. It's not necessarily the code that we write, because it's very hard to screw things up with JavaScript in the browser, but if, I don't know, some databases are experiencing problems, or there is, I don't know, Ireland has moved by a millimeter from the continent, and some ISP services are going down, we've lost some data centers. It's just geography, and that's it. You can do nothing. You have to wait until Europe restores connection to North America.
Yes, but the question is, how far back does this responsibility go? I mean, you release some product, and 5 months later, you are still checking this product? Or do you then hand it to somebody else?
No, yes. The answer to your question is yes. If you release the product, you are being responsible for that. But as you may imagine, we want to update the product, and we don't want to release something and leave it in that state for the next 5 years, especially in the Skype engineering. Have updates coming out pretty frequently. So more or less, old versions of the product are dying out on the desktop environments, and on the web, it's almost like it is, right? You roll out the new version, there is no need to support the old version because it's getting replaced in instant. Okay, but yes, there are cases when we switch from product to product, right? So if we had product A has been developed into production, then yes, we have people still maintain that, but it's getting lower attention because we are going to replace that by the new product thing. So it's like a fine balance. If there is a product, old one in production, we want to update it as fast as possible.
So basically what you create, you will take responsibility until it basically stops being used.
Stops being used, or you replace it with something else. The newer version comes out, that's it. More questions? Okay. Coding and testing and tools. The things that we have in place, code reviews and design reviews. Right? Design reviews are very important. So this is part of this focus group discussion here. When PO comes with an idea, before writing the code, there's a team of people who discusses the technical approach, what's possible, what are the options, and we aim to choose the best option. We don't just go and execute blindly on the first idea that comes to your mind. Design discussion technically happens around each PDI more or less, right? If PDIs are on the right side, it doesn't take too much time. They're easy to understand, easy to work on, but still, we want to talk about what's possible, how you can implement this before you write the first line of code. We thought it's called design review. So some technical design approach, architecture, components, dependencies, breakdown, interfaces, contracts, all that has to be thought through and designed up front. Right? And we want to pick up the best option. Maybe there are three ways how to do things, but one is preferable in terms of longer term maintenance, but it will have less impact on the rest of the product. It's not that tightly coupled, it will have less dependencies breaking when things go wrong, or if you want to replace it with something else, it will be easier. So we take all that into account. Try to balance the immediate execution of the backlog with longer term approach. And then code reviews are mandatory for like absolutely almost every. Right. Except it's like some comment in the code online change like, forgot the comments and you say code something like this. Yeah. May skip it and do the code review. But otherwise code reviews are mandatory. Then it has to pass through different people to get you several code review approvals first before you can hit the code. And may happen that it goes through several iterations, right? So you think your feature is done, you wrote all the tests, all is good. You put it to the product, to the latest state, and we have the way to test that internally in the team before it gets production. Right? So engineers have access to the latest thing in the development. And before even putting it there into this latest state, some other engineers have to approve your code. And maybe during this review, there will be some more issues raised or things being found. And sometimes it happens that people redo things with feedback provided from code review. Although that's also not a good indication as well, right? Because if you need to change something, it means that the design stage weren't well done. Didn't consider all the cases. But feedback from the code reviews is taken seriously. Something is not agreeing with the approach, right? We are not talking about style again, how the name arrives at realities, and we have the shared understanding. But if there is a three comments, let's say, which are approving and saying that code is great, but somebody, one person, is saying that hey, this one word has to be taken seriously, it can't be dismissed. And then technical sessions. So every week, every 2 weeks, depends, mostly like every 2 weeks. We have a technical session on internal things, new frameworks, code areas, design, visual design, anything, almost anything. What's interesting to the team and what's relevant for the product is being shared. And everybody feels free to attend. Right? So welcome to the team. Somebody will present the topic. The topic is how do you do knockout observables with the latest version? How it helps you, or React, Node.js, things like that. So people get together in the room, somebody presents, you share the knowledge, share the ideas, how to build things better, what is going on out there, right? Maybe there are new tools on the market, or new idea how to write code better, faster, or like less bugs, how to approach unit testing, things like this. So this not only is like technical talk, but it also creates common engineering culture, because during the sessions there's not only talking but discussion, not only one guy presenting but common discussion about the proposed idea. And then how do we test? Like, as I mentioned, we don't have formal separation of the testers in Sky. We don't have a guy who's like tester and he only sits and clicks the mouse and here and there. That's monkey job. We don't want to have that. We have engineers who are responsible for the product. What do you need to do to build a great product? It's like all included, right? Having the right unit tests, integration tests, end-to-end tests, visual tests, accessibility, localization, hyper-communication, all that stuff is being included into the development side. It's not being separated out. So on engineer level, you start with unit tests. They are part of the review, so if a reviewer doesn't like the test or wants to have more tests, that's what we consider. Integration testing, so a few more components playing together around the API. Then product levels, automated frameworks, before we check in the code, or put that into the repository, or roll out a new feature, there is a framework which runs automatically on every commit and runs this end-to-end user scenario, sending a message to the other one or starting the code, things like that. And then organization level, people just use their product day-to-day. We have, they are not mandatory, but it's very positively taken when people use the latest state of the product internally first. We call it dog food, right? And it goes from famous saying, somebody did that in Microsoft many, many years ago and said, eat your own dog food, right? Before selling it to other people, try to eat it first. And we do that. And you can do almost anything. So I'm not here, I'm not talking only about Skype itself, but for example, latest version of the Windows. You sign up for the dog food, you will get it updated every day. You will have to use it, of course, right? If you sign up for dog food, it also puts a little bit of the responsibility. It's not just for fun. The contract is it's like a two-way interaction. First, you get access to the latest, greatest product, but you also have to give some feedback, right? Provide the information. If somebody goes wrong or there is an issue, prep, for example, it's now good for the fooder to collect this piece of information together, logs and screenshots, and send it back to the product team. And all the dog food programs and products that we roll out internally, they have this feedback cycle integrated. So normally, two buttons, smiley and the set phase. And if something wrong is with the set button, you click on the set phase and it asks you in a touch, describe the case, what has happened, attach the logs, whatever you need, or vice versa, the smiley face, right? Maybe you like how this feature is being changed. Just click on the smiley face and provide the feedback. So the product team gets this all the time from all other engineers and product managers and bosses and whoever in the organization. You can sign up almost for Skype interface. So it's a web application that is being developed in the team where I'm a part of. We have the footers internally, they send us feedback before we ship this version to production. We give it a little bit of a baseline internally, gather feedback. If somebody feels strongly that it's not good, we may want to hear that. Or vice versa, if people really like it, cool, that's a good indication that we are moving in the right direction. So these local programs are now very easily automated. We don't have to download something and search for things. Just one place, go sign up, get it automatically installed, automatically updated. You don't have to worry. Tools. Jira, please, Jira. For Scrum, for now, cool. And yeah, it's for popular. And related processes, you know, it's backtracking, backlog management. And Source code is in Git repositories. Currently, as you know, probably the latest versions of the Visual Studio and TFS, they do support Git repositories on the backend. So it's kind of cool. And everything else is up to the team. We don't want to dictate things, right? You're free to use whatever editor or debugger or even operating system. We have people with Macs. That's not the problem. Unless you install some non-profit software. It has to be licensed, of course, right? So free software as well as things that are free to download and use, and they have appropriate license for commercial use. So it's not an issue. And everybody is free to choose whatever they think is. Okay, one more slide before we have questions. What's the time? I think we're about.
We are out of time.
Out of time, actually. Okay, I wanted to talk about scale, but maybe I already touched on that. How do you do things? Yes. So question, something that I didn't cover, something I forgot to talk about. Please ask. You see my email there, so if you want to, yes, please.
Okay, so I'm interested how are all the people like from UX experience, user experience, how they are involved in Agile? How do they work?
That's a great question. Basically, it's part of the first phase of the idea discussion from the PO side. So if there is a product idea or some feature that we want to add, and it requires visual interaction or design for visual interaction, there is a team that does design throughout the scan. Right? We want to, as you may have noticed that in the past, every client looked a little bit different. Now all the clients are always saying, we want people that they are familiar, right? If I use my desktop computer, you scan there, then I pull out the mobile from my pocket, it's the same experience. I don't want to look for where is this function there. So we have a team that provides this common language or user experience process to all the clients. So our POs talk to them, talk to these guys, and usually they are already aware, right? The features don't come out of the blue. They are aware that this will be the next cool, sexy stuff added to all the clients. So let's hash out the design first. They already have some proposals, designs put in place. So when the PO comes to them, this is how we would like to do it. Or if it's a totally new ask coming from some specific team, process is almost the same. PO talks to design team, gets back some ideas, how it can be done, puts them into the spec, team gets to discuss them. If they see it as reasonable and feasible, here we go. If the designs are hard to implement or they don't consider some specific corner cases, for example, the team gets feedback to PO, PO talks to design. Okay. We have this slightly special treatment of visual design because, as I said, we want to have unified, consistent, and familiar experience for our users across the products. So you cannot include, or you can, technically. We tried that in the past as well, right? In the past, what we did, we had designers as part of the Scrum team while working on the features and executing on the backbone. It was quite challenging for designers because they have to attend, like, I don't know, 5 or 10 different teams. It's the same thing done everywhere. They have to accommodate for different time zones. Microsoft is a global company, and Skype is also very distributed. They have to attend for different specifics of the team, right? Speak different languages, maybe, and all that stuff. It's hard on them. So we have them together, and they provide input to PO's on how to design things or how the visuals should look.
Okay, thank you.
More questions?
How long do you do that? Like in sketches. How long do you do that? Scrum,
Skype? That's a nice question. When you say that, it implies many things, right? And it's changing. We don't have the same state of Scrum today as we had 2 years ago. Okay, that would be my answer. So one of the first slides, if you remember, was somewhere here. Yeah. So that's when the transition started. So about 2009, 2010, that's where the change of the mindset to adopt Agile methodologies and Scrum in particular has happened in Skype as a big organization. But the actual implementation of Scrum varies in teams. As I say, we value teams more than the book. Right, so if it works for a team and they want to change it, feel free. We have teams which go from implementation A to B, right? For example, from vertical to horizontal over 2 years. They started with vertical, and after 2 years they end up with horizontal. And the teams next to them are working on something similar to go the other way around. They have horizontal separation first and then they go to vertical because it works. It helps them deliver, they think it's right for the current stage of the team, taking into account the dynamics, the size of the product, the complexity, lessons learned, all the feedback, the retrospectives, it's dynamic. So overall, I think we have a rich history. It's like 6 years by now, and we had, and it was actually a big luck that we had very great support from Microsoft as well, while adopting a Scrum as a big organization, because it's not trivial. It's absolutely not trivial. When you have one team of 5 people, it's easy. You just take a group and implement it. But when you have 50 teams, different size across the globe, they have to talk to each other, have to adapt and scale that to that size. And Microsoft has supported the effort. We had lots of coaches and very recognized names, people coming here to Prague as well to give us Scrum Master training or Scrum Teams training, explain how to do the things, or sometimes we exchange experience between the sites, right? You know, people in London, Tallinn, Redmond, Palo Alto, so we travel between the sites. People talk about how they do things. So we learn not only from the outsiders and famous guys who basically established the Scrum itself, but also to each other. We want to learn from each other. We are an organization. We want to have a similar approach. Yeah, I think it's 6 years.
So is the whole Sky running on Scrum now, or some teams can do Kanban or whatever you want? Or for example, the UX designers, they work also in Scrum, or they have different systems?
As I mentioned, designers now, they are not included into the Scrum sub-teams because it's very hard, right? It doesn't scale very well when you have one design team for all your products. But yes, we give flexibility to the teams to pick up modifications. So using Kanban, if you have good reason, it's possible. And we do have them. We do have teams who use Kanban. But it's more like, you know, it varies, right? Time passes and people change and conditions change, so we go from one process to another. Usually we try to have a shared understanding and shared group of things across the organization. So you don't tell others, hey, you should stop doing Kanban, do Scrum, but it's a learning, right? Talk to each other, show the value of having a shared understanding and shared tools and shared process, because it becomes more easy. There is less integration overhead. But yeah, flexibility. Teams are bad if it works, why preventing them good. Okay? Nothing else? Okay, thank you. Thank you.